Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series we've been studying for a while is on the book of Matthew. This particular lesson is lesson number 12 in that series for June 18th of 2016, entitled Jesus' Last Days. You could guess that that would be very near the end of the book of Matthew, and most of our passages will be found in Matthew 26 and 27. So we would encourage you to get your Bible out, and we'll move forward. For right now, let's bow our heads and ask the Holy Spirit to guide us as we study these passages. Our kind and wonderful Father, it's a great privilege to honor you by studying these final events in your life, and what an incredible impact it has had on this world already, and a greater impact it will have in the future. Help us to be able to touch on some of the most important points here is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That final week, I don't know whether you have tried to stop and ask yourself what was the most important thing that happened in that final week. Of course, most people would probably say the death and resurrection of Jesus. But apart from those obvious choices, what other things would you choose? Our Bible study guide has chosen to take a little bit different approach because so many people have already talked about those major issues. It's going to talk about freedom and free will and how that impacted the choices made by Jesus, Mary, Judas, and Peter. So those are the things we're going to be talking about in our lesson here. Let's see where that takes us. Can you think of any really important lessons you've learned from those final events in that week for those four individuals? Well, by our free use of our free will and the bad choices that we have made, starting in the Garden of Eden, we've allowed sin to multiply. At the end of his earthly ministry, Jesus had to exercise his free will to make some very difficult decisions, and probably it would be more correct to call it his determined choice to answer some of the major questions in the great controversy and choose to die on behalf of the entire universe so that we can know the truth about him, his Father, and the Holy Spirit, and know the falsehoods perpetrated by Satan.
What do you mean by determined choice?
Well, clearly the things he said in the Garden of Gethsemane and some of the things he said during his trial and then the things he said on the cross suggest that these weren't easy choices. You know, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. That's not saying, bring it on, let's have a drink. It was a challenge. It was a challenge for him. Well, one of the challenges that we need to look at, and we've talked about this before, but I thought we should focus on it because this is the critical point in the story of Jesus. After spending so much time with Jesus, how could his disciples still, wouldn't we call Jesus the greatest teacher who's ever lived? Yeah. I mean, I think all of us would agree with that. Why couldn't he get those firmly entrenched ideas about Jesus becoming an earthly king? Why couldn't he get that out of their brains after 3.5 years for some of them, maybe more for some of them?
Maybe that tells us something about how God teaches. He does it rather quietly. He doesn't try to intimidate and persuade at the same time. He doesn't pummel them into submission. And this freedom to make a choice, which is the basis of love, mm-hmm. takes a lot of time. That's why he's very patient. He is not operating on a time schedule.
Yeah.
So we have to keep that in mind.
No one can give him a deadline.
No, he's trying to win as many of his intelligent creatures into a harmonious relationship to last for eternity. Mm-hmm. And that's the way he's done it since he first started to create.
Yeah.
That's why I perceive it.
Yeah.
May I also say something about how we learn?
Yeah.
Exactly.
And especially about how we don't unlearn. Well, just look at some passages. I thought it would be good to look at these. Jesus had explained repeatedly to his disciples that he would go to Jerusalem, where he would be handed over to the Roman authorities, he would be killed, and then 3 days later he would rise to life. He explained that. Remember his discussion with Peter. We've already discussed that back in Matthew 16, especially verse 21. That same experience is spelled out in Mark 8, 31 to 32, and Luke 9, 22. A short time later, he said basically the same thing with a little bit more explanation, Matthew 17, 22 and 23, Mark 9, 31 and 32, Luke 9, 43 to 45.
Was it important that it happened just that way, or could there have been other ways that he could have used to accomplish all of this? Was it necessary that the Romans are the ones that put him on the cross? The priests have done something, or is it?
Presumably so. It would have been possible. The Romans ended up being the ultimate authority at that point in time, because Herod and some of his sons had killed so many people for no reason at all whatsoever. The Romans came in and said, "That's it. We're taking charge. Nobody can be put to death except by Roman authority." So the Jews sort of called that down on themselves.
Was this in part somewhat prophetic of what happens in these kinds of situations? Whenever God's followers are facing difficult times like this, is this a typical scenario? Is the government involved? Is it prophetic about the end times?
If you go to the book of Revelation and you study the symbolism that's in there, it talks about beasts, and we know that beasts represent governments, and they're going to be causing a lot of, or church organizations in some cases maybe, they're going to be causing a lot of trouble for God's people at the end of time. Yeah.
Why did the woman understand with the alabaster jar?
The thing that's crazy, if you stop and read carefully, Judas understood it. And then if you go along, the Pharisees and the Sadducees apparently suspected this might be possible. They understood it. What's with the 11?
Their hearts were set on something else.
Yeah, I guess so.
Was the devil especially working on them?
Probably. Does the devil have the ability to hide something from our knowledge or from our understanding?
He distracts us from it. Probably the easiest way.
Well, just to summarize, this is just one. We could read all those verses. This was the final time. Jesus is on his way up from Jericho to Jerusalem on the last trip. Okay, we're looking at Luke 18. I'm going to read from 31 to 34. Luke 18, 31 to 34. They're with a huge crowd, big celebrating crowd. They're headed up to Jerusalem, and many of the people in that crowd believe that they're just about to crown Jesus king. They really believe that, okay? So in the midst of all that shouting and hallelujahs, Jesus took the 12 disciples aside and said to them, "Listen, we are going to Jerusalem, where everything the prophets wrote about the Son of Man will come true. He will be handed over to the Gentiles, who will mock him, insult him, and spit on him. They will whip him and kill him, but 3 days later he will rise to life." But the disciples did not understand any of these things. The meaning of the words was hidden from them, and they did not know what Jesus was talking about.
And when we say hidden, and the way that's phrased, it's easy to imply that God hid it from them. Is that really the case, or was it just hidden from their own? It was their own perceptions that kept this hidden from them.
Well, and I really struggled with that question earlier this week when I was studying and preparing for this lesson. I thought, if God was really trying to hide it from them, why did he repeatedly talk about it? And it's in all the Gospels, 3-4 times that we know about, and probably a lot of times we don't know about. I mean, you wouldn't think that God would keep saying it if he was trying to hide it somehow. That doesn't seem to be logical to me.
And here he is explaining what's going to happen to him, but he doesn't explain or what the we call the efficacy of his death was going to be.
Yeah.
The presupposition that people, oh, you've stepped out of line, God needs to be appeased, and this is the time he's going to do it. He could have expounded on even a couple more verses could have done it. It's not there, period.
The Gospels, none of them discuss why Jesus had to die.
Absolutely not.
Why?
He came here to teach how to live. He came here to show us what the Father is like. It's that simple.
Mm-hmm. Well,
you've gone through at least these three occurrences in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And in the handout you say, why isn't it in John?
Yes.
Why isn't it in John?
Well, that's a good question. What do you think? I'll throw that out before I tell you my version of things. Why isn't it in John?
Well, John, we are assuming, it's my understanding, that was the last gospel written.
It was written probably at least 30 years after all the others.
John is covering the things that everybody else left out.
Well, also, he's trying to do something, I think, to try to correct some of the misunderstandings. Because you go through the Gospel of John, you'll believe. You go through your Gospel of John, right, a number of times he says, you'll believe. So he was trying to correct some things, that misconceptions here toward the end of the first century A.D.
Well, for whatever it's worth, the three Gospels, what we call the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, spend all of their time, except for that final week, all the first half of their Gospels, more or less, talking almost exclusively about events happening in Galilee. You go to the Gospel of John, and he covers almost exclusively what happened in Jerusalem. Does that make a difference in this question? See, all the explanations about why, and his explanations to them, they all happened way outside of Jerusalem, far away.
Well, Matthew 13, was it 13:34? Says, Jesus did no teaching except by the means of telling stories or parables or figures of speech. But we don't get to we get to Gospel of John 16, and he says, I'm not going to tell you plainly. I'm not going to talk in parables or figures of speech. I'm going to tell you plainly about the Father. I don't need to pray the Father for you because the Father himself loves you. And then the disciple says, now you're talking plainly and not in any riddles. Mm-hmm. So it's, 70, 80, 90 years, at least 60 years after Jesus died.
Well, there's an interesting story. Let's read it in Matthew 26, 1-16. When Jesus had finished teaching all these things, he said to his disciples, in 2 days, as you know, it will be the Passover festival and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. There's another example, Jay. He just sort of mentions that just casually off the cuff. Oh, by the way, a couple days from now, I'm going to be crucified. You know, there should be lights blinking, horns blowing, and the disciples said, what? There's nothing. It just goes on. Then the chief priests and the elders met together in the palace of Caiaphas, the high priest, and made plans to arrest Jesus secretly and put him to death. We must not do it during the festival, he said, or people will riot. So, in other words, this has to happen in the week before the festival. Most people think this is Passover week. It's actually the week before Passover week.
I have a question.
Yes.
In Luke 18, what you just read, Jesus took his disciples aside and said to them, listen, we are going to Jerusalem where everything that the prophets wrote about the Son of Man. Where is that?
That's a tough question, and I wish I knew the answer to it. Some people have suggested that there's materials that have gotten lost, maybe inspired materials that have gotten lost. The passages which are usually quoted as referring to the life of Jesus from the Old Testament, of course, Isaiah 53 is a very famous one, and the last part of 52. There's four sections near the end of Isaiah that are called the suffering servants passages. people pick up parts of that that they say apply to the life of Jesus.
Well, it makes it sound like they had something there that these disciples should
have known.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if there's something there, wouldn't Jesus have told them?
How about Isaiah 9?
Yeah.
You know, here he's called Everlasting Father, Almighty God. I mean,
to go along with that, there's Micah 5:2. We know he's going to be born. There's Daniel that says when he's going to be born. So there are those kinds of sort of things.
And even in Genesis, there's
3:15.
On the way to Emmaus, he expounds. He starts with Genesis and goes through and explains to them all the things that the prophets said regarding this and why this needed to take place. It'd been nice to have that all written down.
Yeah, somewhere. Wouldn't it, though?
Too bad we don't have those texts.
Got to have a handout for
one, two, three, four, five.
I want a digital recording.
Yes.
Exactly what Jesus said.
It needs to be video, though, because he hit himself, and I am.
I'd be willing to settle for just the handout.
Yeah, well.
Just the outline.
But in a way, if you look at it, the way God communicates to finite beings, he doesn't give us written documents. He didn't give us this, you know. We say he preserved it. Man, if that's preservation, I think it's pretty amazing because we can come up with far better ways to preserve things. No, he works quietly on your mind over time, gently.
Gordon, that coming in second place to the handouts that we don't have, we have our handouts. People can get those.
Yeah.
You can get those.
You can go to our handout to our website at theox.org, that's not com.org, theox.org, and you can get the handouts that we use, and of course they're from Scripture and they're from some of the writings of Ellen White.
To continue on the point of the road to Emmaus, I actually suspect that a number of the sermons in Acts, such as Stephen's sermon and so on, probably outline the things that Jesus said on the road to Emmaus. So I think we may have those.
I think the general outline was probably the same. Yeah. Well, let's go back here. We're going to talk about Mary for a few minutes. Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon, a man who had suffered from a dreaded skin disease. Of course, some call that leprosy. While Jesus was eating, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar filled with an expensive perfume. Now, I want you to notice, we're reading from Matthew, there's no identification of who this woman is. Okay? The disciples saw this and became angry. Why all this waste, they asked. This perfume could have been sold for a large amount and the money given to the poor. Now, elsewhere we know that this perfume she poured on Jesus was valued at an entire year of an average working man's wage, an entire year's salary for an average working man. And it makes you wonder where she got that money.
Makes you wonder where the got the perfume.
She was wealthy.
Yes. And now let me go way out on a limb, and I'll tell you why in a moment. We're told that this Simon was a Pharisee. There, we're going to read a statement a little bit from Ellen White saying that Martha and Mary and Lazarus were his nieces and nephew. So it's very possible that they were also Pharisees, that their family was originally.
Women?
Well.
Or who they were.
At least from a Pharisee family. Okay.
But, no, she understood you as saying, I did for also that the women were Pharisees.
Well.
Exposed to it.
Yeah, at least they grew up in that kind of family.
Yeah.
And Pharisees were pretty generally quite wealthy. So that might be where she got the money. There are some who suggest that she got the money from her former profession. I think that might be a little bit of a stretch. Anyway, she pours it on the body of Jesus. And what is Jesus' response? Jesus knew what they were saying, so he said to them, why are you bothering this woman? It is a fine and beautiful thing that she has done for me. You will always have poor people with you, but you will not always have me. What she did was to pour this perfume on my body to get me ready for burial. Now, just a moment ago, he said, 2 days later, I'm going to be crucified. Now he's talking about being buried. Are there bright lights and horns blaring? No. Now, I assure you that wherever this gospel is preached all over the world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. Judas agrees to betray Jesus. Next, Then one of the 12 disciples, the one named Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and asked, "What will you give me if I betray Jesus to you?" They counted out 30 silver coins. Now, how much is a silver coin worth? That was the usual wage for a working man for a day. One of these silver coins, and gave them to him. From then on, Judas was looking for a good chance to hand Jesus over to them.
So is that today like a $100 bill?
Probably. Something like that.
Maybe more.
Well, it's interesting. I'm not going to read it at all, but you go back to Luke 7, quite a ways earlier in the story. A Pharisee invited Jesus to have dinner with him, and Jesus went to his house and sat down to eat. In that town was a woman who lived a sinful life. She heard that Jesus was eating in the Pharisee's house, so she brought an alabaster jar, and the rest of the story sounds almost the same. So the question is, are there two stories, almost exactly the same thing happening, or is this two accounts of the same story? And Luke, for some reason, decides to put it early in his gospel, and the other gospel writers put it late.
One event.
This is too bizarre, too way out of story to have happened more than once. Yeah. And Luke puts it back there earlier in his account, almost certainly because he's going to go on in chapter 8 and so forth, talking quite a bit about women. I think he wants to put this story there with the rest of those stories, sort of emphasizing his point. Well, here's Ellen White's comment. Christ might have extinguished every spark of hope in Mary's soul, but he did not. The heart searcher read the motives that led to her actions, and he also saw the spirit that prompted Simon's words. "Seest thou this woman," he said to him, she is a sinner. They're not arguing about that. I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. And he said unto her, thy sins are forgiven. And then those present, thinking of Lazarus, now who is Mary related to?
Lazarus.
And Martha, right? So it's Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, okay? Those present thinking of Lazarus, who had been raised from the dead by Christ, and who was at this time a guest in his uncle's house, began to question, saying, who is this that forgiveth sins also? But Christ continued, thy faith has saved thee, go in peace. Now, that was found in some written by Ellen White, Signs of the Times, May 9, 1900, paragraphs 14 and 15. Now, let me just speculate here. What kind of a person was Martha? What do you think of when someone mentions Martha, in the Martha from the Bible?
House proud, maybe.
And very concerned that everything does just right. She's a perfect hostess. Yeah, exactly. So if Simon wants to hold a big banquet for his friends, who do you suppose might have been in charge?
Martha.
Probably Martha. And
keep that Mary away.
Yes, exactly. Mary was not invited for reasons we'll see in just a moment. But Lazarus was invited. Why was Lazarus invited?
Well, he was the main attraction.
He was a huge attraction this month because he's just been raised from the dead, right?
Everybody wants to come and see this.
Yeah, exactly. So here's Lazarus sitting beside Jesus. Here's Martha busy serving people. And where's Mary? Well, read on. As did Nathan with David, Christ concealed his home thrust under the veil of a parable. He threw upon his host the burden of pronouncing sentence upon himself. That's a very clever way to do it, isn't it? Simon had led into sin the woman he now despised. Is this his incest? She had been deeply wronged by him. By the two debtors of the parable, Simon and the woman were represented. Jesus did not design to teach that different degrees of obligation should be felt by the two persons, for each owed a debt of gratitude that never could be repaid. But Simon felt himself more righteous than Mary, and Jesus desired him to see how great his guilt really was. He would show him that his sin was greater than hers, as much greater as a debt of 500 pence exceeds a debt of 50 pence. Desire of Ages 566, paragraph 5. And then reading on to finish out the story. The one who had fallen, whose mind had been a habitation of demons. What do we know about the past story of Mary?
Seven devils, wasn't it?
She had had seven different devils cast out of her by Jesus. Go back over and read Luke 8, first three verses.
Took several times as well.
Yeah. Was brought very near to the Savior in fellowship and ministry. It was Mary who sat at his feet and learned of him. Okay? It was Mary who poured upon his head the precious anointing oil. So Ellen White doesn't hesitate to say who was involved here. Luke called her the sinful woman, and Matthew doesn't mention her name, but Ellen White says, and bathed his feet with her tears. Mary stood beside the cross and followed him to the sepulcher. Now, Mary was first at the tomb after his resurrection. It was Mary who first proclaimed a risen Savior. Would you have chosen, if you had been the General Conference Committee, would you have chosen Mary to be the first gospel minister?
No.
No.
I was wondering why the delay there.
Being careful.
But God did. He chose to... She was the first one that Jesus revealed himself to in person. She was the first one to carry the message to the disciples. Hey, his body is missing.
God has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the wise.
Mm-hmm.
Paul says.
So why did Mary wash Jesus' feet with her tears and pour expensive perfume onto him? Well,
she understood what was happening.
Well, what did she understand? She had heard Jesus speak of his approaching death, and in her deep sorrow and love and sorrow, she had longed to show him honor. Now, she apparently started with at least partially understanding what was going on here. At great personal sacrifice, she had purchased an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very costly, with which to anoint his body. But now many were declaring that he was about to be crowned king. And if we know the story of the sequence, what happened the next morning?
Triumphal entry.
The triumphal entry. There were hundreds, thousands of people were sure that Jesus was about to become the king. So now, breaking her box of... she was eager to be first in honoring her Lord. Breaking her box of ointment, she poured its contents upon the head and feet of Jesus. Then as she knelt weeping, moistening them with her tears, she wiped his feet with her long, flowing hair. Desire of Ages 558 and 559. Wow, what a story. I mean, imagine Jesus there, and he looks around the table, and he can read the hearts of everyone there. From Judas to his competing disciples, to Mary, to Martha, to Lazarus, to Simon. Wow. Well, modern movie makers, as you know, have tried to make something very scandalous out of the relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene. The Bible pictures her much more like a sister. Okay, let's go to Judas. Judas, one of Jesus' own disciples, was already plotting how to betray his master. At the same time, Mary, her heart overflowing with love for Jesus, broke the alabaster box and poured the perfume on his body. That perfume had cost her, as I said before, the equivalent of 1 year's salary for a common working man. What was the most important thing that Jesus did for Mary? Forgiving her sins and loving her? Casting seven demons out of her? Giving her eternal life? What has he done for you and me?
Eternal life.
Eternal life. Sounds pretty important, doesn't it?
Now, was this perfume, I think we had mentioned years ago, that this alabaster box with the perfume was meant, I mean, that was used for keeping the smell of decaying bodies.
Yeah, some people have suggested that, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Why did she put it on, because he was there for dinner, why did she do that at that time versus?
I mean, that's a good question. What she says is she thought, she heard him talking about his death. So she thought, okay, I'm going to be prepared for his death. And then she's hearing, oh, no, we're going to crown him king. So I think she says, let me be the first one to crown him. Honor him as the new king. Well, what were Jesus and his disciples eating on Passover, this Passover celebration?
Lamb and bitter herbs.
Yeah, roasted lamb and bitter herbs. That's the standard meal. We don't include that in our communion service anymore. We celebrate with a little tiny, usually a little tiny, you know, yeast-free wafers and some grape juice. Jesus is in transition now from the old Jewish ceremony pointing forward to his death to the new communion, what we call communion service, pointing back to his death. Would you say that those two services should be a celebration or a memorial, a weeping ceremony?
Why couldn't
the Passover, what was it to celebrate?
Getting out of Egypt.
Wouldn't that be a time of rejoicing? Surely, I would think so. If we believe that the communion represents the broken body and spilt blood of Jesus, which is makes our salvation possible, is that a reason for rejoicing?
It seems to me it's a combination of both, a memorial and a rejoicing.
Yeah. Well, on that Thursday evening, as they were partaking of the Passover meal, roasted lamb and bitter herbs, Jesus introduced a new ceremony, taking the bread and the wine and telling us that these were symbols of his broken body and his spilt blood. The Passover lambs that had been offered for so many years pointed forward to the death of Jesus. We now celebrate with the bread and the wine, pointing back to the victory which came at the cross. But the cross is certainly not the end of the story.
Say, it's a ritual to point to the same thing, mm-hmm. but just back, mm-hmm. not forward.
Yeah.
So that's one reason why we don't have the sanctuary anymore. Mm-hmm. It's one reason why we don't have sacrifice animals anymore, mm-hmm. is because those pointed forward to the blood and the sacrifice to come, mm-hmm. and this is the designated ritual to point back. Will there be anything heaven? You know, it seems like we've had sacrifice since sin entered, always pointing forward, mm-hmm. until Jesus came, and now we've got something pointing backward. When Jesus comes again, I'm going to go to heaven. Is there any indication we'll have? There's supposed to be a temple in heaven.
Yes, there is.
Jesus said, "I won't drink of the
fruit of the vine,
grape juice, basically, until I do it with you again."
Well, here's the question. If the crucifixion had been the end of the story, would we be celebrating it?
Probably not.
No, because Paul says if Christ is not raised, then we're still dead in our sins, and we're to be pitied.
So now a question I asked to some other friends recently, I want to ask you. Which is more important, the crucifixion or the resurrection?
Yes.
And what you're supposed to say, it's a bad question. Yeah.
They go together.
They go together. Yeah, they absolutely go together. Without the crucifixion, there would be no need for a resurrection, and without the resurrection, there would be no need. I mean, the crucifixion wouldn't mean anything.
Well, there's no other way he could have died. Could have.
Well, maybe there. I mean, if you're talking about, did it have to be a crucifixion? Maybe not. But the basic idea that he was killed by and gave up his life to answer the questions really in the great controversy is what we're really talking about.
Well, one of the great lessons there by that act is that sinful humans, creatures that God has created, because of their entrapment in sin and their delusion of sin and whatever, all of that will seek to actually destroy the Creator.
Yeah. Amazing. Amazing. Well, there, thing about the experiences in the upper room. After Jesus had sent Judas out of the upper room, which we had time to talk about that, to do his terrible deed and had finished giving his messages to the disciples, they proceeded to the Garden of Gethsemane. And you can read about that in Matthew 26, 36 to 46. Hopefully that's a familiar story to all of you. What actually was happening there in the Garden of Gethsemane?
Jesus was dying.
Yeah. Jesus was praying, he was dying, he was sweating great drops of blood. He was experiencing for the first time in his life being gradually being separated from his Father. Now, I don't think we have even the faintest notion of what that really is all about.
How could that be if he was there praying in communication with his Father?
Well, he's pleading with his Father, but the Father apparently doesn't respond, does he? They had agreed. There's pretty good evidence for this. They had agreed that among the Godhead that by this demonstration of the truth about sin, Jesus being willing to die this way, humanity would be able to learn how serious and deadly sin is. It is in the very nature of sin that by separating us from God, the source of life, sin kills us, Isaiah 59, verse 2.
So what we're watching there is what sin, the effect of sin is upon the perpetrator and the God, which is the life source.
Yep.
That's what sin does. It's when you do, when you sin, you are taking actions which are separating you from God, which is the life source. You are kind of committing suicide there.
There's a very interesting verse, which I think is everybody should have memorized, as found in Romans 14:23, that says, whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. And I would put that in these simple terms. I'd say faith is whatever brings you closer to God, and sin is whatever takes you away from God. So ultimately, when it's all done and said, sin is going to separate sinners completely from God, and they're going to die because he's the only source of life.
And why hasn't that happened already?
Well,
grace.
Yeah, because he's chosen to keep us alive until we've had a chance to learn the truth and make our decisions.
So what's happening is God's keeping sin going.
Yeah. We're on life support.
That's right. That's right.
The way Jim put it makes it sound bad.
It does. Yeah, I understand that, but it's the truth.
It's the truth. He's keeping Satan alive.
That's right. Most of it shocked people.
When God decides to separate himself completely from Satan, Satan is dead as a pancake. Just like that. Well, reading with the issues, now I'm going to read from Ellen White, with the issues of the conflict before him, Christ's soul was filled with dread of separation from God. So what's happening here? Jay, you asked what's happening? Separation from God, okay? Satan told him that if he became the surety for a sinful world, the separation would be eternal. He would be identified with Satan's kingdom and would never more be one with God. What did Satan claim? He claimed, once you die, you belong to me. The dead are mine. The awful moment had come, that moment which was to decide the destiny of the world. The fate of humanity trembled in the balance. Christ might even now refuse to drink the cup apportioned to guilty man. It was not yet too late. He might wipe the bloody sweat from his brow and leave man to perish in his iniquity. He might say, let the transgressor receive the penalty of his sin, and I will go back to my Father. Will the Son of God drink the bitter cup of humiliation and agony? Will the innocent suffer the consequences of the curse of sin to save the guilty? Well, you can answer that, Ellen White. Desire of Ages, 687 to 690. And this is the follow-up later on Calvary. All his life, Christ had been publishing to a fallen world the good news of the Father's mercy and pardoning love. Salvation for the chief of sinners was his theme. But now, with the terrible weight of guilt he bears, he cannot see the Father's reconciling face. So what's happening? This is from Jesus' perspective, he's being cut off from God. The withdrawal of the divine countenance from the Savior in this hour of supreme anguish pierced his heart with a sorrow that can never be fully understood by man. So great was this agony that his physical pain was hardly felt. Desire of Ages 753, first paragraph. What is going on there? Try to picture it now. Jesus is finding the fact that he's, for the first time in his life, he's being separated, he's been being torn away from God. That was the agreed upon plan. That pain was so serious that his physical pain was hardly felt.
So if he's not feeling physical pain, or hardly
He was feeling lots of physical pain.
Aware of it.
Yeah.
Conscious of it. Not distracted from it. Then he is, instead of experiencing a physical death, he's experiencing an ultimate death.
Yeah. We call it the second death. Yeah. He is literally being separated from his father. And, I mean, think about what I can think about. I just watched a thing on the news just as I was having a meal just before I came down here, where they took a child away from the family she had lived with for years because technically she belonged to somebody else. And both the family and the child, imagine, I mean, you've been with this child for years and you're being torn apart against your will. Well, I mean, we think that's a terrible thing from a human standpoint. Imagine Jesus has been with the Father absolutely perfectly in harmony with his Father for millennia, for eternity. And now they have agreed we're going to be torn apart. Try to imagine that.
And was there a danger in this?
Well, Satan tried to make them think it was a danger. Yeah, there was a danger. One of the dangers was what I just read. Jesus could have said, this is too much, it's unreasonable, there's no reason I need to go through this for these bunch of sinners. I'm just going to leave them.
But so it wasn't a real threat to Jesus himself. He could have, although it was a painful thing.
Well, Satan did everything he possibly could to convince Jesus that if you go through with this, if you die, you're mine and you will never leave here.
But did Jesus know that he couldn't die eternally? Or can Jesus die eternally?
Well, we're going to read a quotation about that in a few minutes, so bear with me, okay?
Is that the Ellen White quote about that he couldn't see through the portals of the tomb?
Yeah. Yeah, that was not here, but there's another one that's an answer to Jay's question. But that he could not see through the portals of the tomb. He couldn't see.
So
okay.
There would have been some uncertainty there.
Yes, very much so. In Gethsemane, Jesus pleaded with his Father to let the cup pass from him, if it is possible, Matthew 26:39. What were the issues involved there? Was Jesus struggling primarily about whether or not we humans were worth it? Was the death of Jesus really necessary? Is it really true that there was no other possible solution to the sin problem? If there had been any other way to resolve the issues in the great controversy, do you think God would have gone through what they went through? Not likely, huh? In light of Christ's incredible experience there in the garden, shouldn't we ask ourselves, do I feel pain when I sin and separate myself from God? We choose to separate ourselves from God by sinning. How does that match up with this story of Jesus?
Well, we're sort of born separated.
Yeah.
So we don't have the intensity of the, you know, like the psalmist says, in thy presence is fullness of joy, and in the right hand are pleasures forevermore. So much of his being was tied up. You know, he spoke of that we might be one as you and I are one. So there was something more than even we. You know, we have trouble with that idea of oneness.
Yeah.
Trying to bring it about in our marriage relationships, but they truly were one and prayed that we would be one. So,
okay, so now we're trying to focus a little bit on Judas, and we're already running out of time. Why was Satan able to control Judas?
Because he knew Judas' weakness. Judas liked to be important and he liked money.
Judas had naturally, and I'm quoting again, Judas had naturally a strong love for money, but he had not always been corrupt enough to do such a deed as this. He had fostered the evil spirit of avarice until it had become the ruling motive of his life. The love of mammon overbalanced his love for Christ. Through becoming the slave of one vice, he gave himself to Satan to be driven to any length in sin. Desire of Ages 7:16. Christ's discourse in the synagogue concerning the bread of life was the turning point in the history of Judas. So that's just at the end of his Galilean ministry. He heard the words, "Except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." He saw that Christ was offering spiritual rather than worldly gain. He regarded himself as farsighted and thought he could see that Jesus would have no honor and that he could bestow no high position upon his followers. He determined not to unite himself so closely to Christ, but that he could draw away. He would watch, and he did watch. 7:19, paragraph 1. Desire of Ages again. Judas made the incredible mistake of thinking that he actually knew better what was right for Jesus to do than Jesus, who was God himself, knew. I mean, think of how preposterous that sounds. He was sure that Jesus was to become an earthly king, and he based his choices on that assumption. Thus, his choices made during that final week were based on a false assumption, which was in turn based on wrong choices he had made earlier in his life.
Of course, the fact that he's going to get a little money on the side didn't hurt any.
No.
Well, but he took it a step further. He wanted to teach Jesus a lesson, in effect, and Judas, once he turned Jesus around, would end up the number one man. So yeah. He was doing the same thing as the mothers of those other disciples did earlier.
Yeah. Judas reasoned that if Jesus, I'm reading from Ellen White again, Judas reasoned that if Jesus was to be crucified, the event's going to come to pass anyway. His own act in betraying the Savior would not change the result. If Jesus was not to die, it would only force him to deliver himself. If he betrays him, Jesus is going to have to deliver himself. At all events, Judas would gain something by his treachery, at least 30 pieces of silver. He counted that he had made a sharp bargain in betraying his Lord. Judas did not, however, believe that Jesus would permit himself to be arrested. In betraying him, betraying Jesus, it was his purpose to teach him a lesson. He intended to play a part that would make the Savior careful thenceforth to treat him with due respect. I mean, it's hard for me to even read this. But Judas knew not that he was giving Christ up to death. How often has the Savior taught in parables the scribes and Pharisees had been carried away with his striking illustrations? How often they had pronounced judgment upon themselves? Often when the truth was brought home to their hearts, they had been filled with rage and had taken up stones to cast at him. But again and again, Jesus had made his escape. Since he had escaped so many snares, thought Judas, he certainly would not allow himself to be taken. Of course, Judas elsewhere, Ellen White says, Judas said to the crowd, "Hold on to him tight." And what he figured was going to happen is Jesus was going to escape, and then he's going to say, "I'm sorry, I promised to deliver him into you, but you didn't hang on to him. It's your fault." So Judas decided to put the matter to the test. If Jesus really was the Messiah, the people for whom he had done so much would rally around about him, would proclaim him king. This would forever settle many minds that were now in uncertainty. Judas would have the credit of having placed the king on David's throne, and this act would secure to him the first position next to Christ in the new kingdom. Pages 720 and 721. Incredible. Well, someone in recent times came up with the expression, "With friends like these, who needs enemies?" Were they thinking about Judas? I wonder. I mean, man. Well, Judas's love of power and position and money led to his destruction. Are we led away by any of those attractions? In a previous lesson, we noted that Matthew, here's a little interesting little note, we noted that Matthew mixed up the two Zechariahs mentioned in the Old Testament. He made a mistake. Read now Matthew 27, 5 to 10. And I'm not going to take actually time to read that, but if you read it very carefully, it'll say, at the end of that passage here, no, it says they went and bought a potter's field. Verse 9, then what the prophet Jeremiah had said came true. They took him 30 pieces of silver and so forth. Well, who was it that said that?
Zechariah.
It was actually Zechariah. So here's mistake number 2 in the Gospel of Matthew. How could that be? Well, try to imagine yourself as Judas, leading that contingent, which may have included up to 600 soldiers, through the city and down to the Garden of Gethsemane. Did it give him a feeling of power? Did it feel like he was going to finally force Jesus to respect him and his decisions? As we know, Judas lost everything, not only the 30 pieces of silver, but also his eternal salvation. One of the challenging questions that many theologians and thoughtful Bible students have raised in recent years is the question of whether we can be truly free if, in fact, God can predict the future. From our limited human perspective, it might seem that if God knows the future, then it's already determined. Doesn't that seem logical? But look at our stories for this week. Did Jesus' foreknowledge of Judas' decisions force Judas to make those decisions? What do you think?
No, I think the devil was riding in the same chariot as Judas along with him.
Yeah. Did Jesus' foreknowledge of Peter and his denial force Peter to make those choices? Well, we know the story of Peter. Up there in the upper room, even if I have to die, I won't deny you, right? And what did Jesus say? Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times, right?
Yeah, thrice.
Matthew 26, you can read it in 51 to 75. After deserting their master in the garden, two of his disciples, I'm reading again from Ellen White, after deserting their master in the garden, two of the disciples had ventured to follow at a distance the mob that had Jesus in charge. These disciples were Peter and John. The priests recognized John as a well-known disciple of Jesus and admitted him to the hall, hoping that as he witnessed the humiliation of his leader, he would scorn the idea of such a one being the Son of God. John spoke in favor of Peter and gained an entrance for him also. Desire of Ages 7:10.
How is it that they recognized John, but they didn't recognize Peter?
That's a good question.
Well, people, as it says, John was a well-known disciple.
Yeah.
Which implies that Peter
was
wasn't.
Unknown disciple?
Not as well known to the
leaders. Yeah.
To the leaders.
There was some kind of family connection or something. Yeah.
Well, there are speculation based on some flimsy evidence. Some people have suggested that the family of John sometimes sold fish to people in Jerusalem. Now, that seemed a little strange to us because they were fishing from Galilee, and Jerusalem's a long ways away. But then again, there's no nice place to fish anywhere closer to Jerusalem. So, I don't know. But apparently, however it happened, they recognized John. Peter had not... So what did Peter do when... Well, what did John do when he got inside? John got as close as he could to Jesus without being in the middle of the fray, where he could hear everything and see everything. He didn't make any pretensions. Peter had not designed that his real character should be known. He's trying to... In assuming an air of indifference, he had placed himself on the enemy's ground, and he became an easy prey to temptation. If he had been called to fight for his master, he would have been a courageous soldier. But when the finger of scorn was pointed at him, he proved himself a coward. Many who do not shrink from active warfare for their Lord are driven by ridicule to deny their faith. By associating with those whom they should avoid, they place themselves in a way of temptation. They invite the enemy to tempt them and are led to say and do that which under other circumstances they would never have been guilty. The disciple of Christ, who in our day disguises his faith through dread of suffering or reproach, denies the Lord as really as did Peter in the judgment hall. Desire of Ages 7:12.1. So what do you think? Was Peter just afraid?
I think he was inclined to shoot his mouth off without really thinking about things here and there till much later, and this was one of the contributing things that started to straighten him out.
The boastful pride of life drives both wanting to be with, at the right hand of Jesus, and then also not wanting to be identified with somebody who's been tried. So it comes from the same source.
Was Peter just surprised when all of a sudden this lady points at me, what do I do now kind of thing, maybe?
Well, certainly the first time.
Yeah, there's an element of that.
Peter had just declared that he knew not Jesus, but he now realized with bitter grief, now this is after he suddenly realized what was going on, he now realized how well his Lord knew him, and how accurately he had read his heart the falseness of which was unknown even to himself. Unable longer to endure the scene, he rushed heartbroken from the hall. He pressed on in solitude and darkness, he knew not and cared not whither. At last he found himself in Gethsemane. The scene of a few hours before came vividly to his mind. The suffering face of his Lord, stained with bloody sweat and convulsed with anguish, rose before him. He remembered with bitter remorse that Jesus had wept and agonized in prayer alone, while those who should have united with him in that trying hour were sleeping. He remembered his solemn charge, "Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation," Matthew 26:41. He witnessed again the scene in the judgment hall. It was torture to his bleeding heart to know that he had added the heaviest burden to the Savior's humiliation and grief. On the very spot where Jesus had poured out his soul in agony to his Father, Peter fell upon his face and wished that he might die. Desire of Ages 7:13, first three paragraphs. Wow. Well, the truth about sin and its consequences and about God and the fact that he always tells the truth as opposed to the lying of Satan had to be demonstrated by for the benefit of the entire universe. As we study the life and death of Jesus, we are given a choice. I've said this many times before, I'm going to say it again. We can choose to live lives like that of Jesus, or we will die the death caused by sin, which he died. Peter was brave enough to attack the high priest's servant using a sword, despite the fact that there was a huge crowd to arrest Jesus. But he collapsed before the scorn of a single servant woman in the court of Caiaphas. Try to imagine that. Why? Well, how do we prepare ourselves for that kind of thing happening in the end of time? It would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour each day in contemplation of the life of Christ. We should take it point by point and let the imagination grasp each scene, especially the closing ones. That's found in Desire of Ages, page 83. We're running out of time. I hope this brief recounting of these last moments of the life of Christ inspire you to think about these stories, to think about what happened there, and to think about what difference it might make in your life today and tomorrow and forever. Our kind and loving Father, what a wonderful privilege it is for us to read these marvelous insights that help us to understand the story in greater depth. Help us to realize what you accomplished from those incredible experiences and that long weekend with those awful experiences that you went through. May we benefit from what you accomplished and turn our lives into your hands and live according to your will each day is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.